Can everyone in the back who wants to hear me is the real question. Okay, well, first off, thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation to be here. It's a pleasure to give these lectures. So in some sense, the overall goal of my talks are to give an introduction to some of the new techniques that are allowing for advances in mixed characteristic, even though this conference is titled Things in Positive Characteristic. But hopefully you'll see as part of the theme of the lectures, often what that means is you're forced to come up with new proofs of known results in positive characteristic, right, that fit into a framework that allow one to generalize them to mixed characteristic. Okay, so I understand that a lot of things in this talk or in my talks may be a little farther away from things that people in the audience have looked at before, so I'm going to try and, at least at the beginning here, give as down-to-earth of an introduction as I can, but please feel free to ask questions. All right, so but throughout all the talks, I'll fix a prime number p, so that'll be true for the whole time. All right, so p won't change. All my rings are commutative with 1. And often, I'll talk about a local ring, RMK, so M the maximal ideal and K R mod M, the residue field. And most of the time, I'm going to assume that so P is inside of the maximal ideal. So all that really means is that the characteristic of K, right, is P. But of course, the characteristic of R need not be. So there are really two cases. Right, so the equal characteristic case right, so here where the characteristic R is also P, right? And it's important, I think, throughout the lectures to keep as many examples in mind as you can, so right, might as well take a power series ring over FP, right? And in contrast, I might take something where the characteristic of the ring is different from the residue field if it was local, right? So, and here I want you to keep something in mind. Namely, the p-adics adjoin, or a power series adjoin, a bunch of variables, right? So note that in the second case, if you're in mixed characteristic and you are a domain, then in fact, just like in this example, your ring has characteristic 0, okay? All right, so right, so start off with just a definition you may have seen before, but so R is perfect, right? If, well, this only makes sense in characteristic P, right? And the requirement here is that the Frobenius map is an isomorphism. In particular, part of the point of writing this is that I don't mean just that it is surjective, okay? All right, so, and in some sense, the goal of my lecture today is going to be to tell you some things about perfect rings and tell you some new interpretations of theorems involving them, right? And then hopefully introduce perfectoid rings in mixed characteristic and try to mimic the same techniques. All right, so let's start off with a couple facts. All right, so if R is perfect, well, the easy thing first, R is perfect means R is reduced. Right? If some power of an element gives me zero, I might as well assume it's large power of P, right? Which means it goes to zero under some big iterative Frobenius, which means it goes to zero, it's zero because Frobenius is an isomorphism. Okay, so, and two, if R is perfect, then R is Noetherian. If and only if R is a finite product of fields. Right, so a finite product of perfect fields. Okay? All right, so let me say a little bit about this one down here just because it's going to come up with something that is a useful observation, right? So so in order to show that if R is perfect in Noetherian, it's a finite product of fields, it suffices to go modulo each of the finitely many minimal primes, right? So right, so say Q is one of the minimal primes, and S is R mod Q, this ring here will again be a perfect ring. Certainly Frobenius is still surjective since it was surjective on R, but now S is reduced still, so it's Frobenius is still injective as well, right? So now my ring is domain. So it suffices to prove the theorem to check that this ring S is in fact a perfect field. All right, so suppose I have some element S inside of S. And what I want you to consider is the radical of the principal ideal generated by S, right? And the claim is that that ideal, which I might write like this, S to the 1 over P to the infinity, is the ideal generated by all of the pth roots of this element S. So this S to the 1 over P to the infinity is not an element. This is just my shorthand notation for writing such an ideal down here. Okay? All right? And of course, again, my ring is perfect, so there's no real ambiguity about anything I wrote down here. Every element in R has a unique, or in S has a unique P or P to the eth root for any E. Okay? All right, so, but we also know our ring here is, by assumption, Noetherian. So this ideal is equal to S to the 1 over P to the n for some large n, right? So these things all divide one another, so I might as well stop at some fixed value, right? And as soon as I get to that, I have, well, S to the 1 over P to the n plus 1 is going to be a multiple of the previous guy, S to the 1 over P to the n. All right? But now I can factor this guy out and divide through. So let me write that out. So S to the 1 over P to the n plus 1 right? All right, so solving or moving everything to the left side and factoring out s to the 1 over p to the n plus 1, the point here is that 1 over p to the n is bigger than 1 over p to the n plus 1, right? So I have an equation that looks like this. My ring now, s is a domain, so that means there are two cases. Either, well, s to the 1 over p to the n plus 1 is 0, which is the same thing as saying s is 0. Or, over here, this is 0, at which point, oh my goodness, I didn't do that. Okay, so, or this is 0, which is the same thing as saying that, well, some fractional power of s is a unit, so in particular, s is also a unit too, right? Right, so this shows that s is a field, right? Is everyone happy with this? Okay, great. So maybe the next thing to say tell you two ways, one of which you've probably seen and one of which you may not have thought about before, to cook up perfect rings, right? So starting at least from a ring of positive characteristic. So say you have a ring R of positive characteristic. So the first way I can cook up a perfect ring is the following. So I'll call this ring R perf, right? So this is the, by definition, the co-limit over all of the different powers of Frobenius. Okay? So in particular, right? So to show you that you've probably seen this before, right? So I claim this is the union. Well, take R reduced, right? And now the Frobenius map is injective. And so I can view the Frobenius map as taking P to the eth roots, right? And the union of all of those rings gives me a perfect ring, namely R red perf, all right? In particular, maybe the best case of this is when R is a domain, in which case I can view all of this as living inside, say, a integral or absolute algebraic closure of the fraction field of R. All right. So, and this is the one you'll find in many of the other lectures, right? And it'll show up at least some in these as well. But in some sense, the new character I want you to focus on is, well, the natural thing to do here is instead of taking a limit over Frobenius this way, you might try and do it in the other direction. Right, so this next ring, I'm gonna call R flat, and this, I might call this for us, this is what's known as tilting, right, later, at least in the mixed characteristic setting. All right, so here, by definition, this is now, instead of the co-limit, it's the inverse limit, again, over all the different powers of Frobenius. All right, so so what does it mean to have an element of this thing? An element of this is some sequence. Right, so of elements of R with the property that R n plus 1 to the p is equal to R n. Okay. All right, so just like when I limit over Frobenius this way, if I limit it in this direction, what I end up with is always a perfect ring. You can check that, okay? So just to have some example down here, let's say R is reduced. All right, in that case, right, this is gonna be the subring. Of all the elements of R that have arbitrary p power roots. Okay? So this is my attempt to have at least one example down here, but let me warn you that this is also not going to be particularly reflective of the cases where R flat is used. Right? So most of the time here, I'm going to use it on a ring R where Frobenius is surjective but not injective, and so somehow very different things happen in that setting. Okay. All right, great. So more generally, for A any ring, I'm going to set A flat to be A mod P flat. All right, so given any ring, go mod P, right? This gives me a ring in characteristic P, and now I'm gonna flat that guy, all right? And again, so just to have it explicitly on the board, this is all right, the inverse limit order of Frobenius on R mod or on A mod P. So, great. So I need to tell you a couple of more things about this tilting map, because it really is, this tilting procedure really is something which is at the heart of the theory, right? So let's say that A is P-complete. And separated, right? So I'll add this whenever I say P-complete, even though it's maybe implicit, just to make sure that you know that I mean it, all right? So the claim is in this case, all right, so well, what's one of the reasons to use the flat notation? So I have some kind of musical notation that goes on here, right? In this case, the claim is that there exists a sharp map right, from A flat back to A, right? And what is this? So, right, so again, A flat here, I can think about as the set of sequences right, after I lift them, is the set of sequences an in A, so that an plus 1 to the p is congruent to an mod p, okay? At which point, what I want you to do is map this, well, right, so I want you to map this just to and the p to the n, right? Or at least take the limit after you do that. So the claim is that if I have a sort of compatible system of roots in A flat, right, that the sequence an to the p to the n, as I let n go to infinity, is a Cauchy sequence in A, right? And since this is p-complete, this thing converges to something inside of A. All right, that's uniquely determined. All right, so one should check that this is well defined. Say it again.
You mean that in I you have a topology?
P complete. Uh-huh. So with respect to the p-adic topology here, right? So. All right, so so check this map is well defined. I'm not claiming that it is a map of rings, right? But at least it's multiplicative, right? If I have products over here, they go to the corresponding product inside of A. Right, so. In particular, one can show that this implies that you get an isomorphism at least of multiplicative monoids, I'm not saying anything about addition, all right, between the following. Well, in the definition of the flat map, right, so I really was looking at the inverse limit over the Frobenii on A mod P, but I could look just at the multiplicative maps, A to A, given by sending elements to their pth powers, and not worry about the addition whatsoever. All right. And that has a natural map to the A flat over here. So maybe more explicitly, an element to the left-hand side here is an honest sequence. An plus 1 to the P equals An in A, right? Without saying anything about addition, okay? And I can take such a sequence and just go mod P, right? To give me a similarly compatible sequence over here in A flat. Right, and to see that this is an isomorphism, the sharp map tells me exactly how to write down an inverse. Right, so simply take the sequence an mod p, right, and map that up to the sharp sequence over here. All right, so and again, right, so the point here is to check, right, that this is in fact the inverse. Okay. All right, so. Right, maybe we just one more remark. So similarly, if R is perfect, and I have some element d0 in R, right, then you can check, well, let's say, if R is D0 complete and separated, then I could take R mod D, right? So since R was perfect, R mod D at least still has surjective Frobenius, but probably not injective Frobenius. I can take this flat construction to make it a perfect ring, and the same arguments are going to give you an isomorphism of R mod D flat with R flat, which is the same thing as R that I started off with. Right? All right, so maybe that's another thing that I didn't say earlier, right? In both of my two constructions here, so R lower perf or R upper flat, if you start off with and take a perfect ring, then in both cases, what you end up with is exactly the same ring you started off with, right? So in some sense, right? This follow the arc here, I've got R goes to R perf, gives me one way of producing perfect rings. R goes to R flat, gives me another way of producing perfect rings. And here I have one example of what R flat looks like, right? So, but maybe not the most representative for these talks. And over here, I have one that was going to show up quite a bit later, right? Namely, take a perfect ring, then R mod something is got surjective Frobenius, right? And this tells me that when I flat it, I end up getting rid of the quotient completely. Okay? Yeah. Yes. Right, so it has to have a compatible system of p power roots. Okay? All right. Okay, so like I said in these talks, in some sense, the theme is supposed to be that when you work in mixed characteristic, one often needs to revisit things in positive characteristic, come up with a new proof that generalizes to mixed characteristics. So with that in mind, I want to tell you today about the following theorem. Of Bhatt, Iyengar, and Ma, right? Which says the following, let's say R is Noetherian. Right? Of characteristic P, right? Then R is regular. If and only if there exists a faithfully flat map from R to A where A is perfect. All right, so, and if you were looking in the previous lecture series, the theorem Ilya had up on the board over here was Kunz's theorem, right? And so the nice thing about doing this is that what you're supposed to see is that this is a new way of revisiting Kunz's theorem, that regularity is characterized by the flatness of Frobenius. Okay? So let me sketch a proof, right? Right, so let's do the easy direction first. Right, so if R is regular, Kunz's theorem says that that's the same as asking that the Frobenius map here is flat, and a colimit of flat modules is flat. Right, so and so R perf will be faithfully flat over A. Okay. Is everyone happy with the easy direction here? Right, so let's look at the other direction, which is the real meat of their proof. Right, so so any Noetherian ring of characteristic P. Regular means regular at all of the local rings, so it's a product of regular domains. All right, so, but feel free to focus on the local case throughout. You do lose nothing, and all the proofs are going to reduce to that anyways. In fact, for this direction, to show, let's say, that you have a faithfully flat map to some perfect ring, right, without loss of generality, I can localize. So I might as well assume that R is local. I'm trying to show then that R localized, that M is regular. Right, so let's fix this system of parameters x1 up to xd. Right, and as we saw before, right, so we know that the radical of the ideal generated by xi and a is the same thing as the ideal of all of the pth roots, right? And the observation here is that, well, I can build this guy up. Right, and view it as a colimit over a bunch of multiplications by powers of xi. Okay. All right, so and the point here then is that as soon as I can write that ideal as a colimit, right, all of these AIs, of course, are free and so flat over A. So this thing will be a flat A module. Right. So I leave it to you to check that you can exhibit it this way, but maybe I'll draw a little bit more to convince you that it's the case. So here, maybe the more obvious colimit that would build up and give me this ideal of all the powers will be to take the ideal generated by xi in the first entry, xi to the 1 over p, and just build it up power by power, right? And these exponents are exactly what one needs to do, right? So this is multiplication by xi. This one then is multiplication by xi 1 over p, right? These multiplications are exactly what you need to write down in order to make the corresponding squares all commute, right? And so the real core of this thing is that this, certainly you have a surjection from this colimit onto the corresponding ideal, right? And the proof then is to say that that map is injective, right? Assuming just that R is reduced. So a similar statement will mean that all ideals of this form in any reduced ring are flat, all right? Okay, and I should say, and based off of what these lectures and this conference is about, this is not a new observation, right? The fact that such ideals in a reduced ring are flat is due to originally Auerbach and Hochster. All right, so how does that help us? Well, in particular, look at the following complex. All right, so stick A in degree 0, stick the ideal in degree 1, right? Both of these things are flat, so each of these is a flat resolution of A modulo the radical of XIA, right? So when I tensor those all together, what I get is a flat resolution, right, of not sure if n was n or n is d. Right, so this gives a flat resolution of A mod the radical of MA. And again here, right, so this is a similar check. Namely, I want you to argue that this statement about the radical of finitely generated ideals inside of perfect rings being the same as just looking at the ideal generated by the p to the eth roots for all e. Okay, right? But since each of these has length 1, this guy has length d. Right? I.e., the flat dimension over A of A mod MA is at most d. Okay? So, what do I get from this? Well, that tells me that if I look at a tor of anything over A into A mod MA, this is 0 for I bigger than d, okay? So in particular, what I'm going to stick in here is k tensor over R with A, okay? And using that A is flat over R, this is the same as the tor over R from K into this guy. So I can put an extra tensor A in here using that's flat, all right? So maybe I'd say it another way, right? What I can do is I can always take a projective resolution of K over R and tensor up to A. Since that's flat, that gives me a projective resolution of this guy over A, and then I can use that to compute the torus. Okay? All right? All right, great. So I have this tor vanishing statement, right? And the point here is, on the other hand, this guy here is a K vector space. I don't know exactly how big it is, right? But it is some R module, which is killed by the maximal ideal, right? There's at least one copy there, right, from faithful flatness. Okay. So this tor breaks up is a bunch of direct sum copies of tor from K to itself, right? over R. So the end result is that for I bigger than D, Tor K into K, right, is zero, which immediately gives that that R is regular. Okay. Is everyone happy with the sketch of the proof here on the board? And so I'm going to revisit this proof later. If I don't make it to it in this lecture, then I will at the beginning of the next. All right? But I want you to take a look at it. And the key point here is once I have the faithful flatness to make the rest of the argument go through, all I really need is that the flat dimension of A mod the radical of MA is bounded, is finite, right? So then I'll get some bound on the global projective dimension. Yeah? Yes, absolutely. All right, so let me tell you where we're headed. Right? Sort of the first theorem then is I want to take this and do the same thing in mixed characteristics. We've just done it in positive characteristic. And I'm going to write the theorem without telling you exactly what it means. And then in some sense, that's our next goal. Right? So same theorem, right? But let's say R is Noetherian. And let's say P is inside of the Jacobson radical of the ring. All right, so in particular, as an example, take where R is local with P inside of the maximal ideal. All right, then the statement is that R is regular if and only if there exists a faithful flat map to a perfectoid ring, right? And so the first sort of goal in the lectures is to tell you, right, what a perfectoid ring is, okay? And the argument is that they are the analog and mixed characteristic of what perfect rings are, all right? And so that is the foot in the door that allows us to make use of Frobenius techniques and things like that in mixed characteristic, all right? Is everyone happy with the statement of the revised statement of the theorem? I say revised because it's not clear that it is the same theorem yet until I make the following remarks, right? So I'm going to tell you what a perfectoid ring is in general, right? But in some sense, I don't want you to worry too much about the definition if you haven't seen it before. Instead, I'm going to tell you the two easiest cases you should keep in mind that will give you a flavor for everything that's going on. Right, so what are the easiest perfectoids? Right, so, well, the first one we've already seen if you're an equal characteristic P, then A is perfectoid if and only if it's perfect, right? I.e., another interpretation of this is once you know this, this statement in equal characteristic P is exactly the previous statement. Okay? All right, so that's not the interesting case. But maybe it's worth saying that maybe before this lecture you might have had the impression that perfect rings were pretty easy to deal with in positive characteristic because you only work with R infinity maybe before and nothing else. And, all right, so at least I'm wary enough at this point that to know that the flat or the tilting construction leads to very complicated, interesting examples of perfect rings, and even in positive characteristic. All right, so second one. Let's say that A is P torsion free, right? then a perfectoid if and only if, all right, is p-adically complete and separated. Right? And P has the following form, right? P can be written as a unit times pi to the P, right? I.e., up to a unit, P has a pth root inside of A. Okay? And one more. Right, so the last thing. Well, write it like this. Look at the Frobenius map on A mod P, right? What I want to require is that that is surjective with kernel generated by pi, right? Or said in other words, the Frobenius map induces an isomorphism between A mod pi and A mod P, right? So P up to a unit has a pth root, and that generates the kernel of Frobenius on A mod P. Is everyone happy with this? All right, so, maybe I should also say that throughout all the lectures, certainly the definitions I'm gonna give are not the first definitions of perfectoids that showed up in nature, right? So I'll try and give some attributions. Right, and so this one appeared first in the work of Botmore and Schulze. Right, so as I said, the idea of these boards were supposed to tell you some easy examples of perfectoids, and maybe everything here was some theoretical mumbo jumbo that's, while very easy to check in practice in many cases, not explicit. Let's do one, right? So, or at least do two. Take the p-adics that you started off with, right? Well, okay. So let's not think about this too much, but here's what I want you to do. Take the p-adics and enjoin all pth power roots of p itself. Okay? So each one of those extensions is, in fact, a free extension of degree p. All right? So this is now an infinite extension here of zp. Okay? As such, while adjoining the roots at any finite step preserves the fact that what I have is P complete, after I go infinitely many times, now an infinite rank free module is no longer complete, right? So take the P completion, okay? And so this is, in some sense, maybe the easiest perfectoid ring you can write down. You can do the same thing with some variables as well. Take ZP. Great. All right, so this is one that's going to show up of importance later on. Take a nice, beautiful regular ring in mixed characteristic, right? And I want to map this guy to a perfectoid in an obvious way. And what I'm going to do is adjoin pth roots of both p and all the variables again. All right? And then again, I have to worry that because I have an infinite rank extension, it's not P complete. So the obvious thing to do is P complete. Okay? And in both cases, right, all of these rings are p-adically complete and separated. They're p-torsion free, right? And it's not just that p has a root up to unit, but p has a pth power root because we adjoined it in both cases, right? So it's very explicit, right? Of course, you should also check that when I go mod p, this thing is an isomorphism, right? So I leave it to you to go home and do the exercises of checking that what I get, right, actually gives an isomorphism in these cases. Okay? Okay. So let me end my talks with giving you what to do tonight, right? So for exercises. So the first thing is to say that a lot of my, well, I haven't followed it directly, one of my favorite sort of Cliff Notes versions of a lot of the intro theory, right, is in fact in this paper, the Bott-Jangermaur paper, right? So if you like, go ahead and take a look. There is a section on reviewing basic facts about perfectoid rings, right, and it's a good place to look at if you're trying to get some of this basic material down, right? And the second thing is, so I will give you the full definition of a perfectoid next time as we go through and give a sketch of the proof of the theorem, right? But in order to do so, I need to use the whip vectors, right? Namely, the p-typical whip vectors, right? And I'm old school, or just old, depending on your perspective. So my favorite source or where I learned the basic facts, in fact, is in Serre's local fields book, right? So if you like, go look at the section on whip rings or whip vectors inside of Serre's local fields, and I'll start recalling some of that construction next time.